Hey, this is the 80 Slasher Librarian, just letting you guys know if you enjoy the content here on the channel and want to support the channel, click on the Patreon link in the description below. As I'm not allowed to monetize the channel here on YouTube, I depend on you guys to keep this channel going and growing by becoming patrons of the channel and sponsoring at the Patreon page. There's great rewards for doing so in tiers as low as $2 to $5 per month.
Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, Part 6. Hell Cop and Highway to Hell. Hey, I just want to make sure you guys know you're listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
Hi, this is Kane Hodder, better known as Jason from Friday the 13th, Victor Crowley from Hatchet. I've also played BTK, Ed Gein. Let's just say I've murdered a lot of people. In fact, I've murdered more people on film than any actor in history. So just keep that in mind. You are listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.
You're with your baby.
Friday the 13th, Part 4, the fan novelization by Landon Turner. Chapter 6, The Hunt Begins. As the thunder approached in the distance, and as the lights from the rental house shone on the surface of the lake, another slow song hummed through the speakers of the gramophone, as Sarah and Doug pressed close to one another in one corner, and Paul and Tina slow danced in the other. Ted and Jimmy sat on the staircase like sad puppy dogs, watching the lovers with dismay. "That asshole, man, I'm gonna kill him," Ted said angrily, glaring at Paul, pressing close against Tina. How did Paul manage to do it? He'd only known the twins for a few hours, and he already had them literally taking off their underwear for him. "Actually, Ted, I want to talk to you for a second," Jimmy said. "Not now, dead fuck," Ted said flippantly. "That's what I want to talk to you about," he continued. "I really don't... Do you believe this guy?" Ted interrupted him. "I had her. She was mine." Jimmy let out an annoyed sigh and leaned in close. "Well, you know what, Ted? How about you run that through your little computer?" Ted gave Jimmy a dirty glare as Jimmy smirked evilly and sauntered off into the kitchen. Ted watched him leave with narrowed eyes and then turned his attention to Terry, who was coming his way. Ted jumped to his feet. "Hey, you want to dance?" Terry scoffed, rolling her eyes. "I'm just using the bathroom, teddy bear," she said mockingly, and pushed past him up the staircase. Ted watched her climb up the stairs in disbelief, watching her firm ass flex in her spandex shorts. He bit his knuckles in frustration and plopped back down on the steps, defeated. "God, I feel like an asshole," Paul thought, as Tina rested her head on his shoulder. But this girl was smoking hot. So was Sam, but sometimes Sam would just be in a weird mood and he'd have to go take a cold shower. He was sick of it. He wanted a simple girl that wouldn't ask questions or get upset over every little thing and would just have sex with him, and there didn't have to be anything weird about it. Not talk about their feelings or their relationship, just sex. He pictured what both of them looked like together, kissing him, kissing each other. It was a dream come true. He knew he was pissing Ted off, but he didn't care. There was something about this girl, something softer than Sam, that he couldn't put his finger on. Wait, what the hell am I doing? He thought. He loved Sam. He knew he did. He didn't feel the same about other girls that he did with Sam. Sure, other girls were hot, but there wasn't any emotional connection. he actually had something more with Sam. He didn't know what it was, but she wasn't just a quick lay. She was smart and funny and could be nice when she wanted to be. That's why he decided to go steady with her in the first place, because she was different from the other girls. He could throw it all away right now for some random sleaze from this hick town that he had only known for 3 hours, or commit himself to the one girl who he knew he wanted to spend the rest of his life with. No, fuck this, his mind screamed, but he still found himself pressing into her, smelling her perfume, her long flowing auburn hair soft against his skin, her ample breasts pushed up against his chest. He couldn't tear his hands away from her hips. She was irresistible. Be strong, damn it, he told himself. This was some girl you just met. Sam is a girl you will marry. You can't do this. Paul pulled away from Tina, shaking his head. What's the matter? Tina asked, dumbfounded. I'm sorry, I can't go through with this, he said, and with that he hurried out the door. Tina stood there in disbelief, throwing her hands in the air and falling back onto the armchair. Great, just great, she thought to herself. This whole night was ruined. Finally, she had a whole house of out-of-towners with incredibly sexy guys to fuck. She was so sick and tired of the same guys from her school. Most of them are hillbillies or delinquents who spent their time parked in their pickup trucks just outside of town getting wasted, and the few that she and Terry rotated around were the only ones worth anything, but even they were simple farm boys. Tina wanted something new and exciting. How thrilling it would have been to get to have sex with a city boy. She could tell all of her friends at school, and she'd be treated like a goddess. But Paul was too busy being a slave to that slut Sam, and Doug was with Sarah, and now all that was left was Jimmy and Ted. She took one look at Ted, who was holding a small teddy bear and pretending to dance with it, and sneered. What a total dweeb. She looked over at Jimmy, who came in from the kitchen and sat down on the couch. He was kind of cute in a boy-next-door type of way. Definitely wasn't her type, but then again, this weekend had planned to be about getting around and trying something new. It may not be thrilling, but it certainly could be new. What the hell? He would possibly be better in bed than Ted. Sensitive guys can be such a turn-on, but she hoped he wasn't a virgin. Tina stood up reluctantly and ambled nonchalantly over in front of Jimmy. Do you want to dance? Jimmy's eyes widened. Dance with me? Tina nodded, grinning coyly. Sure, Jimmy stammered, and jumped to his feet, pulling her into him. She wrapped her arms around his shoulders, gently swaying and back and forth to the music. Jimmy laughed nervously. I thought you wanted to be with Paul. Well, now I want to be with you, Tina said, brushing his lips with her fingers and looking into his eyes. Jimmy laughed again in disbelief, seeing the way she was looking at him. Well, I kind of feel bad. I mean, you and Paul were kind of, Jimmy continued, but Tina brought a finger to his lips. God, just shut up already. I'm horny as hell, Tina thought. Let's go upstairs, Jimmy, Tina grinned mischievously, running her hand through his hair. Jimmy didn't have time to react. She took him by the shirt collar and tugged him up the staircase. Jimmy gave Ted a look and followed her up the stairs like a kid following candy. Ted looked on in astonishment. Sam! Paul called into the pitch-black darkness as he jogged down the trail towards the lake. He couldn't believe how stupid he had been. He had almost lost a sexy, intelligent bombshell of a girl for some girl that he had just met. A girl who he would probably never see again after they all went home back to their lives. He began to mentally prepare himself to face her, because when she was angry, she would throw, kick, hit, scream, and everything in between. Paul was surprised she hadn't gone totally nuts on Tina back at the house, but it was all that passive-aggressive shit that girls did, hating each other from a distance, and it was vicious. Guys just got it out in the open. If two guys are pissed at each other, they let everyone know. Girls sneak around and give fake compliments and sabotage and never go right at another girl unless she is pushed to her absolute limits. Most of the time, all of the fighting was done behind each other's backs. And when Sam was angry, really angry, there was nothing passive-aggressive about it. What was she even so goddamn angry about? Because he was dancing with another girl? He wouldn't have minded if she started dancing with Ted or Jimmy, as long as they didn't get too handsy. What was the big problem? Sam could be so obsessive sometimes. Was that the price of having that piece of ass? It really started to take a toll on him sometimes. At lots of parties and hangouts they had been to, Sam had done things like this before and ran off without speaking to anyone just because some girl was talking to him. She was crazy jealous. But at school, Paul had to constantly swat guys off of her like flies. So what about that? He never got upset about that, you know, every time that she interacted with another guy. What was the big deal? Everybody was just having a good time, and now she would probably be mad the rest of the night and totally ruin everything. They'd probably make up with sex, and then she would be fine again. It was really good fucking sex, too, and Paul didn't mind her blow-up so much if it meant having that kind of sex. He figured this time wouldn't be any different. But as he approached the dark, quiet lakeshore, he began to wonder if this was the best spot to get it on. He shivered in the frigid night air. Paul squinted through the layer of hazy mist hovering the surface of the lake. He could make out a rubber raft floating not too far out in the middle of the lake, and an arm was draped over the side. "Samantha! Sam!" he called. No response. Was she asleep? "Sam!" he called again. Still no response. Great. Was this his punishment, having to swim all the way out to her in freezing cold water? That was just the kind of bitchy, passive-aggressive thing Sam would do. Fine, if that's the way she wants it. Paul stripped off his clothes down to his boxer shorts and dove into the water, every muscle in his body tightening in response to the cold. Knifing through the icy water, he raised his head and squinted his eyes, trying to see into the raft, but the thick fog obscured his vision. He stopped to catch his breath. "Sam!" he called. Still no movement from the shape lying in the raft. He swam up to the raft and peeked over the side, and the hair stood up on the back of his neck. It wasn't from the cold. It was from the sight of Sam's corpse, her dead eyes gazing up at him, lying motionless in the bottom of the raft in a murky mixture of lake water and blood. Paul recoiled in shock, screaming and leaping away from the raft, thrashing around in disoriented terror, until he finally found enough composure to start swimming as fast as he could back towards the dock. He felt the wooden slats of the dock above him, and he felt the old jagged wood splintering his hands as he struggled to pull himself onto the dock. As he managed to heave his upper half onto the pier, he caught a glimpse of a shadowy figure through the wooden slats, coming down the dock towards him. In a split second, the long shaft of a spear gun was thrust out from underneath the pier, plunging into Paul's groin. Paul's entire body writhed in the throes of pain as the spear penetrated deep into his manhood, and a blood-curdling, agonizing scream erupted from the bottom of his soul. Before he knew it, he was lifted into the air. A huge figure withdrew from the darkness underneath the dock, and the two menacing eye holes of a hockey mask met Paul's pained stare. That was the last thing he saw as Jason pulled the trigger, and the spear fired through Paul's pelvis and out through his lower back in a spray of blood, impaling him like a fish on a harpoon. Rob was jolted awake from a restless sleep by a chilling scream. He pulled himself out of his sleeping bag, threw on his flannel shirt, not bothering to button it, and scrambled for his machete in the sheath near the tent flap. He unsheathed the long rusty blade, grabbed his flashlight, and ran outside the tent he had pitched in a small clearing. He glanced around, the beam of the flashlight bouncing around crazily as he tried to listen for another scream like the one he had just heard. It had come from the lake. Rob sprinted down the trail, running headlong into thick brush, slashing at branches in his way with the machete. "Hello! Do you need help? Where are you?" Rob bellowed, waving the flashlight frantically. He stopped for a moment to catch his breath and find his bearings, pointing the flashlight around until he found the trail again. He kept moving down it, cutting aside any foliage. "Hello?" he called again loudly. He stopped to listen, but there wasn't an answer to his calls. Maybe he had just dreamt it. No, that couldn't be it. He wasn't even all the way asleep when he heard it. At least he didn't think he was. He had heard something. "Hello, are you out there? Do you need help?" he called again. Still no answer. He made his way through the dark woods listening, trying to hear anything other than his own panicked breathing and the light rainfall that had started to pour. Shining his flashlight in every direction, he couldn't see a thing except for trees and pitch-black darkness. He had to save them. Someone could be in trouble. Someone could be fighting for their life. He couldn't let anyone die tonight. He had come too far not to seek the vengeance he came here for. Rob kept moving towards the lake, wincing as thorns slashed his arms and legs. Finally, he could see the moon glinting off the surface of the water behind some clouds for a brief second. Then he thought he saw the moonlight illuminating someone moving down the shore of the lake and disappearing into the shelter of the trees. "Hello!" he called. "Is someone there?" Then there was a huge crash of underbrush behind him, and Rob spun around to see a huge dark figure dash across the trail. The figure was headed in the direction of Rob's tent.
Hey!
Rob yelled at the top of his lungs and gave chase, swiping a branch in half with the blade of his machete. He followed the sound of the crashing underbrush, waving his flashlight frantically in one hand and his machete in the other. "Damn, he's fast, whoever he is," Rob thought, and just as he saw the tree root in front of him, he tripped on it and toppled over, sending his machete and flashlight flying. He felt a jab of pain shoot up his leg as his knee hit the ground hard, and he cried out in agony. "Shit!" Rob exclaimed, struggling to pull himself to his feet. He found the yellow beam of his flashlight and picked it up off the ground, and shone it around until he found his machete. Using a tree for support, he pulled up his pant leg, shining his flashlight on his leg. A small gash oozed blood just below his knee. Wincing at the throbbing pain shooting up his leg, he rolled back down his pants and started towards his tent. Whoever had just came barreling through here was long gone by now. It was probably just a deer, but he could have sworn it had the shape and build of a man. Rob hobbled up the trail until he reached the clearing where his tent was and stopped short when he saw something that made his blood run cold. The backside of his tent was ripped to shreds, like someone had torn right through it. "What the hell?" Rob muttered, tightening his grip on his machete and approaching the entrance to the tent. He peered through the opening and froze in horror. "Oh, shit," he said. Someone had been inside his tent. His newspapers and magazines were strewn all over the place, and his rifle had been snapped in two like a twig. It had begun to rain and thunder was rumbling in the sky. Lightning flashed and dark clouds obscured the moon, making the night seem even darker and more ominous. "So, have you ever done this before?" Tina asked, as she and Jimmy both sat down on the edge of the bed in the upstairs bedroom. Jimmy ran his hand through his hair nervously and chuckled. Yeah, he stammered. Tina stood up, spun around to face him, and unbuttoned the first few buttons of her blouse, grinning at him seductively. "I think you're pretty neat," she said, and pounced on him, kissing him passionately. They both flopped down on the bed, hands wandering. Jimmy couldn't believe what was happening, but he only registered the shock for a split second. What came over him next was nothing short of pure ecstasy, as her hand slipped inside the front of his slacks. She straddled him, and Jimmy arched his back with pleasure as she sat firmly on his crotch. In 3 seconds, she had her top and bra off, and Jimmy was staring at her succulent, ample breast, and they hung down over him as she kissed him again. Her tongue slid inside his mouth and met with his, and his hands found her ass and began to slide off of her shorts. In the next 20 seconds, they were under the sheets, inside each other and moaning with intense pleasure. Terry stared with disgust across the room at Ted, who rifled messily through the contents of a small wicker cabinet, a joint hanging loosely from the corner of his mouth. Doug and the Goody Two-Shoes were over on the couch, snuggling and whispering sweet nothings into each other's ears. It made her want to vomit. Tina was getting some, and she was downstairs with the biggest loser at this party. At least Jimmy was kind of cute. Maybe she was just too much of a bitch. This was what she got for it. Stuck downstairs with the rejects while her sister was upstairs screwing a pretty cute guy. If she would have given Jimmy a chance, maybe it would have been her getting laid. Maybe it was what she deserved. Was it the way she walked or talked? The way she carried herself? She knew that her mother would have said. Her mother always said that some guys were just intimidated by confident women. But maybe she really was just a bitch. "What the hell is this?" Ted asked aloud, pulling out a reel of film. "It's film, Teddy. I think I saw a projector in one of the upstairs closets," Doug exclaimed. "Oh, shit!" Ted guffawed with laughter, stoned out of his mind. "Let's see if it works." Ted tried to climb down the stool he was standing on and nearly toppled over the entire cabinet, sending the knickknacks crashing to the floor. He bellowed with boisterous laughter again, cackling in a fit of cannabis-induced hysterics. Terry rolled her eyes. "That's it," she thought. "I can't take much more of this." Terry stood up and headed for the stairs, climbing them two at a time and strolling down the hallway, following the moans of passion. She rapped on the door where the moans were the loudest. "Tina, Tina, I'm ready to go," Terry yelled. No answer, just further passionate moans in the throes of ecstasy. "Tina, let's go." "You go," a voice called from between moans. Terry frowned. "I'm going to leave without you," she exclaimed. After a moment, Tina's voice came through again. "Take an umbrella," she said in a spiteful tone. Terry leaned away from the door, her jaw hanging open. What a bitch, she thought, and to think, Terry was the one with the reputation for being a bitch. "Fine," Terry responded, and stormed down the hallway, downstairs and towards the foyer, where she grabbed a poncho hanging from the coat rack. She didn't care that it wasn't hers at this point. She had to get out of here before she blew up at everyone. Tina with a bloody nose would put a damper on a party, she thought nastily. Putting it on, she ignored Ted, calling her and asking her not to go, and left the house, banging the door shut behind her. Terry began to jog through the pouring rain towards her bike, the one leaning against the kickstand beside Tina's, underneath an old overhanging tree. She wanted to kill her, just kill her with her bare hands. She had wanted to break down that door and kill her. But she knew she had to be the bigger sister and act like an adult. So here she was, leaving the party early alone and in the rain. She still couldn't believe it. How could she? Her own sister was letting her go home all alone, at night, in the rain, while she fucked some guy she just met. Of course, that was their goal, was to have sex with some new guys and have a fun time, but aren't sisters supposed to stick together, party together, leave together? Surely there's some sort of girl code that must be even stronger for sisters. Twin sisters, even stronger. One thing was for sure, she wasn't talking to Tina for a week. It was always how she got back at her, and she knew only then would Tina be begging for forgiveness. Every time Tina did something stupid like she always did, she would always come crawling to Terry to get her to fix her mistakes, or to forgive her. They were supposed to be in this together. Well, to hell with that, because her sister was a whore. Terry angrily snapped the kickstand back into place, and just before getting on her bike, she looked up at the brightly lit bedroom window. "Slut!" she screamed through the pouring rain. Terry began to hop onto her bike, when all of a sudden a huge meaty hand clamped down on her shoulder, and another hand plunged a spear into her back. Terry let out a scream that was drowned out by the rain and thunder, and stared down at the metal tip of the spear that protruded from her gut. Jason lifted her into the air. The spear impelled through her abdomen and hurled her like he was shoveling dirt into the side of the rental house. She hit with a dull thud and fell to the ground, quivering in the throes of death and feeling the warm blood flowing between her fingers as life drained from her body, along with the rain that ran along the dirt path. 3 down, 5 to go. Tommy, I'm going to towel off and then I'm going to strangle you, Mrs. Jarvis said, as she stepped inside the darkened cabin, shuddering from the rain she was soaked in. She had told him over and over not to leave the door unlocked. That psycho who murdered those kids at the old camp could just come waltzing right in. She sighed, closed and locked the front door, and trudged through the house into the kitchen. She grabbed a dish rag off the counter and mopped the rain from her face. What a perfect time to decide to go for a nighttime jog right before the bottom fell out, Mrs. Jarvis thought sarcastically. She poured herself a glass of water and glanced around, sipping it plaintively. She glanced around. Where were Trish and Tommy? They should be back from town by now. She had told Trish to take Tommy into town for a haircut before the storm started, and it looked like they were stuck right in the middle of it. She stared out the kitchen window at the rivulets of rain trickling down the glass and the lightning flashing across the sky. Thunder boomed overhead, rattling the walls of the old cabin. Trish, Tommy, anybody home? Where the hell are you? She called. She tried to squint through the dark interior of the cabin. Matter of fact, where the hell am I? She tried the light switch, but the cabin remained bathed in darkness. Trish? She called again. No answer. There must be something wrong with the lights. She hoped they'd be all right out there in the rain at night. The dirt road leading to the house could get slippery, and that old hunk of junk Trish was driving wasn't going to be any help. They would have had to walk home today if not for that guy that Trish found on the side of the road. She shuddered to think about it. What was his name again? Rob, that's right. The stranger Trish had allowed to just come over into their house. What could have happened if she hadn't been home? Would he have taken the chance to rob them? Hurt her children? Try to rape Trish? She shouldn't have thought about it, and she scolded herself for thinking such awful things. But she couldn't help it. Ever since the news of those murders, she had been thinking the worst. Mrs. Jarvis tried the light in the living room, and it didn't work either. Storm must have blown the power out, she thought. She would have to go out to the fuse box and try to fix it. Those poor kids that were murdered, she thought. Some of them were probably right around Trish's age. She heard on the news that only one girl survived, and she was so traumatized she was sent to a mental institution and was inconsolable. She was around Trish's age. It was so bizarre. They moved away from the city to get away from awful things like murder and robbery, only to get to the country and some whack job goes on a killing spree. Well, at least he was dead and gone. Mrs. Jarvis finished the water and set the glass in the sink. Thwack. It was something hitting the side of the house. Mrs. Jarvis moved to the back door and peeked out, but the night and the rain obscured her vision. It was probably Gordon wanting to be let inside. Great, she thought. He was probably covered from nose to paw in mud. She opened the back door and stepped out onto the porch, the wood sagging under her feet. Gordon! Gordon! She called through the howling storm. Another thud came from around the corner of the house, and Mrs. Jarvis craned her neck to see, but it was to no avail. The rain was coming down too hard for her to see much of anything. She climbed down the porch steps and hurried out into the storm, the rain stinging her face. Gordon! She called again. Come inside, Gordon! Here, boy! She ran around the side of the house and came to a screeching halt. There was someone lying on the ground in the mud. It was a girl, and she wasn't moving. Beside her was a bicycle lying on the ground. Mrs. Jarvis had little time to react. Just as she started to open her mouth to scream, she looked up right into the eye holes of a hockey mask, and she saw the terrifyingly huge man wearing it. There was the flash of a blade, and the lightning illuminated the hulking figure towering over her. Her scream was cut short as abruptly as it had begun, as the machete made contact with skull and bit deeply into her cranium with a sickening thud. She was dead before she hit the ground. One by one, the rain drummed down on the roof of the rental house, and the thunder cracked like a gunshot sounding off, drowning out Mrs. Jarvis's choked scream. I hope Samantha and Paul are all right, Sarah said, looking over her shoulder out the window. Doug wrapped his arm around her and pulled her closer on the sofa. I'm sure they're fine, Doug said. They probably made up and are shacked up somewhere. Ted had the projector and film screen set up in the living room. The reel of film he found was some kind of stag movie from the 30s. It was black and white and grainy and out of focus. The entire thing consisted mostly of a topless girl dancing around drunkenly, or sitting in a bathtub, or doing other mindless acts, but Ted found it hysterical. Then again, he was high, off of a messily rolled joint dangling from his fingertips. Sarah and Doug couldn't help but snicker as Ted leaned back in the armchair, guffawing with laughter uncontrollably, puffing on the joint. Is this what Ted always does? Sarah asked Doug. Pretty much, Doug said. So, which bunk are you taking? Sarah hesitated. Oh, it doesn't matter, actually. I was thinking you could take the bottom bunk, she said, trying to put on her best sexy face. Why do you want the top bunk? Doug asked, confused. Sarah shook her head coyly. Doug's eyes widened with shock. Was she actually making a pass at him? Sarah never wanted to do anything outside of making out, and he understood it, after all. She was a virgin, and virgins were typically scared about their first time. It had been hard the past few months, though. Paul was his best friend, and he'd been getting pussy ever since middle school, and Doug had only had sex once. It was embarrassing. Paul and Sam pretty much had sex at every party they went to, and Sarah never wanted any part of it. What was a guy to do? He would often space out on dates with Sarah, not even hearing what she was saying, just because he was imagining what sex would be like with her. He'd have to fantasize, otherwise he'd go insane. But now Sarah was staring at him, her eyes sexually charged, and Doug grinned from ear to ear. Do you mean? Doug started to say. But Sarah put her finger to his lips. Just give me a few minutes, okay? She said, and stood to her feet. Good night, teddy bear, she said as she walked past Ted towards the stairs. Ted gave a wave and another cackle of stone laughter, and Sarah climbed the stairs to the second floor, leaving Doug in awe and disbelief. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 6 of Friday the 13th 4, the final chapter, a fan novelization by Landon Turner. I don't know if you can tell, I'm still a little congested. I had a chest cold, and it was like a week and a half of that. I'm just now getting to where I can talk normal again, at least for the most part. I hope you enjoyed this chapter. I am sorry for the delay, but getting sick happened, and there's no way I could have narrated during some of that time. But I'm back now. I really enjoyed this chapter. Great job, Landon. I'm really enjoying what you did with this book, and I'm looking forward to seeing how you conclude it. We got a little more detail on Mrs. Jarvis's death there. That was awesome. I love the little extra insights into certain scenes, like with Rob and, everything going on with Sam and her man. I'm really looking forward to what comes next. I hope you all are too. Be sure to thank Landon in the comments for writing this book. And if anybody knows of novelizations for the other movies that didn't have official books, let me know and I'll reach out to the authors and narrate them. Or if you want to write a fan novelization or fan fiction of any slasher, if you want it narrated, I'll narrate it here on the channel for you as well. It's been a lot of fun doing this, and I'm glad that I was able to get in touch with Landon a while back and find out about his fan novelization here. Great job. Really, really great job. All right, guys. I'll be back very soon with more of Friday the 13th, the final chapter. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80/Librarian saying thanks for listening, be excellent to each other, and I'll see you soon.